right, we'll move on to the city cases. I believe the first one is CU 202303, Matt, is that correct?
Yes, sir, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a request by Christie Jenkins for a conditional use permit for an event center and highway commercial zoning. Subject property is the Garden Plaza Commercial Center located at 2525 North Ashley Street. That was built about 20 or so years ago. The applicant is wanting to occupy Suite M and Suite O, which is in the near middle of the complex. Aerial image shows the rooftop of the whole facility. The reddish part that you see in the upper left portion, that is a extended stay hotel. And the longer building that you see running from it, that is the commercial center. That commercial center is about 16,000 square feet. And I tried to approximate the location of the suites, which is the yellow dot that you see on the screen. It used to be the 25 North, which I think is a cafe and billiard club that was there. There are several tenant spaces within the commercial center. One of the things that's important to note about the site is that it is non-compliant in terms of the parking requirement. Commercial center of 16,000 square feet, under today's standards anyway, would require 72 parking spaces. There are only 49 spaces in the front of this property that are relegated for the commercial center. There is other parking there, but it is relegated for the hotel part of the facility. Comprehensive plan, part of it, go backwards, sorry about that. Character area is institutional activity center, and that is due to the north campus of BSU, which is across the street, and also the South Georgia Medical Center, which is nearby. But other than some of the institutional flavors of that character area, it is much like the community activity center, which you see elsewhere along Ashley Street. Again, the aerial imagery in your packet is a floor sketch submitted by the applicant, as well as a very well-written letter of intent that's about 2 pages long. We had a very lengthy pre-application meeting with the applicant where we encouraged her to prepare a good letter of intent about the event center. The letter itself is pretty self-explanatory, but it describes mainly daytime operations. Some photographs, subject property, this is the entrance along Ashley Street near the center of the complex. The subject site, which is the Suites M and O, which you see here behind those glass storefronts with the white curtains. And other uses nearby include Andy's Wings, which is a restaurant at the north end of that commercial park, some other uses, and then down at the end is Firehouse Subs. As described in the staff report, staff's overall concern is the lack of parking on this site, particularly during the daytime, lunch and supper hours. Event centers have the potential to bring a lot of people into the building code arena. It's called an assembly use, and typically can pack in more people than restaurants or offices or even retail shops. So that was an overriding concern. Staff deliberated this long and hard. We expressed our concerns to the applicant about the lack of parking in the beginning and did not think we could support it except with some very extreme conditions. Trying to compose such conditions, I found it to be pretty burdensome and hard to enforce. Also in your packet, just wanted to point out some license application history from the applicant. The applicant is currently an events party rental facility. I think she has a traveling roadshow, but with an office base. As her letter describes, she's looking for a home base of operation to both manage her business, but also provide a little event space. She has 2 active business licenses for existing commercial storefronts elsewhere in town. Each of those are in an existing commercial center with very large parking lots. If the applicant were to choose one of those instead, there would be no issue with parking. And so that would be something that staff would encourage them to do. But as far as this request for this location, even though we like the business model that's presented in the letter of intent, this is just not a good location to accommodate what could be some overbearing crowds. Staff has witnessed the parking lot being full on multiple occasions, different times of day, some days not quite as full as others. So with all of that, looking at our standards for for the review of conditional uses, which are there in the packet. We find it inconsistent with those standards, inconsistent with the comprehensive plan, and we recommend the denial of the CUP request. So glad to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Matt. Commissioners, any questions for Martin on this one?
Mr. Martin, I'd like to ask, you stated that the staff has identified and seen instances where the parking lot has been full. Is it, has that been during the operational hours for the lounge's particular use?
It was on a Tuesday evening at 5:30, it was the latest time, so it was supper hour. Parking lot completely full. There appeared to be some activity at this location. Hard to tell which cars go with what, but it was completely full. Zoning administrator went by an hour later and actually ate supper at Firehouse Subs. Had a difficult time finding a place to park. And that was on a Saturday.
Oh, wow. On a Saturday.
And I've been by there, and recently I went by there after our work session. Last week on Monday, and there was a dozen empty spaces in the parking lot there. And that would be a Monday evening, about 6:30, I think it was. So it does vary from time to time, but when I try to go there for lunch, it is most every time very difficult. On top of that, there's three empty tenant spaces there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
It's just a general concern. A very, very small band of 10 people. I mean, obviously not much impact compared to what could otherwise be in that storefront. And I did weigh that into it as well. It's just a concern if you add 50 or 100 people in there.
Well, their maximum capacity for seating is 45 guests.
Yeah.
So
good point.
Say if there are 20 couples, you're adding 20 cars on top of an already packed
right. And if it weren't for the seating, it weren't for the stage and other areas, and I've had a long conversation with the fire department, a lot of times their occupancy loads for facilities of the site will start at 100 people and go up, and then they deduct from there depending on how the floor plan is laid out.
Commissioners, any other questions for Ms. Martin? Right, in that case, we will open the public hearing portion of this case. Is there anyone here this evening that would like to speak in favor of this application? If so, please come forward. State your name and address for the record.
Hello, I'm Christy
Hello.
Nichols. How are you?
Fine, how are you?
I just wanted to address a couple of things regarding the parking, since that was the biggest concern regarding the space. When the parking spaces were counted for the location, the only parking spaces that were counted were on the front of the commercial property. I have photos. There are back parking spots. The whole back of the building is available for parking. I have also reached out to the adjacent property owned by Roger Bud regarding rental of the property space that you can see there. It's the adjacent one. It's in a kind of an L shape there regarding the rental of the parking space. Even though I don't typically do many events that are that big, I specialize in kids parties and baby showers. You'll see there are some photos of the back of the property. Initially, the owner of the property didn't have a fence there, and after my pre-application meeting, I went to her and expressed my concerns about the parking being cut off because of the fence. Since that conversation with her, the closure to that gate has been completely removed, allowing parking to the back of the property. I went out myself today and counted the parking spots with the front from Firehouse Subs down to Andy's Wings and Things. There's a total of 69 parking spaces around the whole complex. Initially, when the owner of the building got it, she was told that she needed to provide parking spaces in the back. They are there, they're painted. Now within the back of the building, there is a storage area in the back. There are three parking spots that I did not count with that total number inside of that white gate that you can kind of see in those photos. Roger Bud has stated that he will allow the property But that would have to be on a weekly basis. There's no contract that can be drawn out, but he would need at least a week's notice. Typically, as an event planner, I have at least a month or two before an event to know exactly what will be needed. Mm-hmm. I do kids' parties. Typically, there is an event. Yes, there may be 50 people, but at a kids' party, the majority of those little people will be kids and they're not driving or operating a vehicle. Mm-hmm. Typically, when I do events, it's not one car per person. It's not always that situation. And yes, there are other businesses in the area, such as Firehouse Up, but please keep in mind, no one is holding a baby shower at lunchtime during the weekday when the parking lot is most congested. It's not there. And also, the other businesses in that area, one would be a clothing store. There's no one, two, three, or four people that are going to be shopping all day at this one clothing store. The other business there is a nail salon. No one is going to be at that nail salon for 5-6 hours. The other property is a loan company. No one will be parked there for 5 or 6 hours. The next building is a hair salon. Same thing with the hair salon. Yes, hair styles may take a long time, but again, no one will be there all day occupying those spaces. Same thing for Firehouse Club. Yes, it is a dining restaurant as well, but I can promise you no one will be there for 5 hours, even at Firehouse Club. Before I was able to find this property, Mr. Derrick actually found the property for me because I did apply for a business license for 1412 East Park Avenue. Mr. Derrick, the fireman, he basically explained to me that this building would not work for me. He made it his business to say, hey, well, here's a property that may work for you. This property is sprinkler. The property on Park Avenue, yes, it has great parking, but the property is not sprinkled. And the owner's not willing to get the property sprinkled. I had them come out and do an estimate. It was $18,000 to get the property up to code to be able to have anything centered there. So Mr. Derrick actually found the property. This property that I'm at was previously a cafe and restaurant, 25 North, would have more people there all day than I would for a 2-hour baby shower, 3-hour kids' party. Also, before that, the owner of the property had a pool hall there. A pool hall is a place where someone would linger around for hours, and it was also a bar. I'm not trying to do any of those things. The events that I will have and hold will typically be no more than 2 to 3 hours. Baby showers, 3 hours, typically is what it is. Kids parties, they may linger a little longer because sometimes it takes a while to get kids kind of calm and get through the festivities. But those two businesses that were there before me, and they were open in that location, they would have brought more of a crowd than I would, considering a pool hall is open all times of the night and through the day serving alcohol. When people drink, they sit and they linger. Same thing with a cafe and restaurant that serves alcohol. People are eating for a number of hours and they're sitting and talking. I'm not doing any of those things. I've also included some of those photos, some of my previous events that I had. I am an event decorator, and the only thing I wanted to do was make it a bit convenient for me so I don't have to load a trailer and ride to a venue and decorate and come back and break it down. I just wanted to make things more convenient and easier on my audience.
Okay, we've just made exhaustive time.
I'm sorry.
Those are all answers. Is there anyone here that you would like to speak, or if
it's,
so, okay, that's it. Okay.
Do I have any questions?
Any questions for Ms. Jenkins?
You mentioned Mr. Roger, but
yes.
Did you, by chance, get anything documented and written to state that he will support you for the parking?
I hear what you said verbally. Yes, sir. I read it from before. The property 1412 East Park Avenue was actually owned by Roger Bud. I can actually call him and get him to email something in because I've spoken with him previously, but I can't sign a lease for that property. It has to be on a weekly basis.
Okay, that was mine. So you didn't obtain anything?
No, sir. It was your property.
Well, that's something to be taken care of. Yeah.
And I was looking at your diagram. It says bar, bar, bar. So
yes,
you will be entertaining other events other than baby showers and what is?
So the diagram that was drawn out is exactly how the building was when we got it. We don't have the ability to tear out that bar. It's actually built in there. Yeah, that is actually how the building is. There was actually a kitchen from the previous restaurant and from the pool hall. That kitchen, there's no longer any like stove or anything in there. The only thing in there is a refrigerator and a freezer and a table that that was left over from the previous two businesses. That bar is something that's there, but in my mind, for that bar, that is a place where you can put food. You can line food, like a buffet line.
So you won't be entertaining alcoholic beverages?
No, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Jenkins. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
We've exhausted the time for those who would like to speak in favor of the case. Is there anyone here who proceeded who would like to speak against this case? Any of those opposed to this case? Seeing none, that will end the public hearing portion of this matter. Commissioners, any further discussion before we call for a motion?
I got something. I think we need to consider, I think it's a wonderful thing that she's doing, but it concerns me that we're trying to go out and solicit parking spaces. I think it should stand, if we're going to be approving that location, it should stand on its own, not what Roger Budd may or may not do, because down the road it may not be there. Nothing against her or anything, it's just that I have been by there, and I go by there regularly, and there's times that there's open spaces, but lots of times it's full, and my concern is the people that's coming to that is going to park right there in front so they can go right in. They're not going to go park down the way a little bit and then walk back up there. So that's the reason I'm saying they need to potentially look at.
Yeah. I feel better knowing that there's some parking in the back now, and I feel like she could, you know, on invitations or whatever, she could direct her parking to the back. Leave the front of it open for, you know, the restaurant. So knowing that there are that many parking spots in the back does make me feel better.
That's one of my questions, Mark, how do you feel about the parking in the back? Let's exclude Roger Budd for the moment, or does he control all the parking in the back?
Well, there are two different owners. Mr. Budd owns the property in the upper left part of the photograph. Normally, the way it would work is we get a shared parking agreement with the property that's being used. As a vendor, what we would have to analyze is if that site, which has a parking demand of its own, if it has extra parking spaces per code to donate. It may or may not, as I do a broad brush of square footage, it will be close. Normally, when a shared parking lot is across the street from the facility that it is helping, it requires a variance. In this case, it could be rolled into a conditional use approval. But the fact that the owner of this other property is her current landlord that she's moving away from and not willing to put it in writing for long term makes me concerned about, you know, the stability of that arrangement. As far as parking in the back, that is, of course, on Mr. Dunn's property. That was originally parking areas for this facility when it was built 20 years ago. Mr. Dunn has turned it into a storage yard over time. It sometimes in the past 20 years, he has cleaned it up, made it back to a parking lot, but has not stayed that way. One of the concerns back there is on paper and even on the aerial, it looks like it has two ways to get in and out of there. The driveway that is on the south end of the building, that is not navigable by a vehicle other than maybe a Honda Civic. It's a very tight turn, not really usable. The only way really in and out is off of Emory. But there is a fence there, the gate would have to remain open. I do not know how much of the storage that's outdoors has been cleaned up. I'm guessing a little bit, probably at the pumpkin. My concern is how long it would stay that way. Obviously, staff of these facilities can and should park back there. Maybe the event organizers of the event can be asked to park back there. For evening activities, I don't know how well it is lit back there or how appealing that might be to patrons, but it is an ongoing concern. It's not in the same level of the parking lot as the front yard.
I mean, I think Mr. Dunn Jenkins mentioned that she made mention of a fence being opened up or allowed to be open and remain open. Was that the fence that you were just referring to, Mr. Martin? So that would enable someone to be able to have access from Emory into the back parking.
All right, any see the fence in the area, it's right in the jog of that yellow line. That was an opaque fence to give privacy to the storage area. I do know the parking to the north of there behind the motel is used by tenants of the hotel. There are hallways that lead out to it. And I think most of the vehicles that you see there, that has always been open to Emory Street. And I think that is being claimed by the residents of the hotel. So it's really that storage area, which in the northerly parts of it, I think there's enough maneuverability room. As you get further back in there, I don't think there's much good room for turning around. And definitely not a good way to go out the south end unless you jumped through what used to be shrubbery into the nursing home site.
I thought she made a good point too, though. I mean, the events are likely not being held Monday through Friday from 8 to 5. They're probably generally going to be evenings and weekends. So that, I mean, that does lift a little bit of the burden. I do understand that, you know, at any given time you could ride by there and that parking lot would be full, but.
Matt, as far, what Ms. Jenkins is requesting the CUP before us, does that limit how many people she can have, or is by the CUP?
Any limits, well, without a condition of approval that sets a limit, it is limited strictly by the maximum occupancy set by the fire marshal.
Okay.
Which is based on the facility size.
Thank you very much. All right, any other questions for staff on this one? Then I will entertain a motion. So what problematic?
Mr. Chairman, I'll attend.
All right.
I may need help. CU 2023-03. I make a motion that we approve this request.
With no conditions at all, just as approval.
No conditions.
Okay. We have a motion to recommend approval by Commissioner Roundtree. Is there a second?
Commission, I
second the approval. We have a motion to recommend approval and a second. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. I think that's six, Molly. Did you count six? All those opposed? Two. So the motion is recommended for approval. I mean, the case is recommended for approval. Thank you.
Good luck.